Okay, morning. Good to see you. Okay, is it the fast that's doing that? Okay, right. We are seeking the face of the Lord and we are pressing into Him. And prayer, the Bible says, pray without ceasing, without end. The Bible says when you pray, not if you pray, right? So prayer is something that's part of our daily lives, right? It is something that we should pursue, seek to do, and be a part of our discipline. Now, I know in this house, we are very focused upon the Word of God, and that is because we follow the way of Acts 2:42, where it says, and they devoted themselves, right, to the apostles' doctrine, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, and prayers. And obviously, we call those the four pillars of community, right? And so four pillars, it means four things that must be built into the corporate lives, right, of the church, where we are devoted to four things: to doctrine, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, and prayers, right? And so the first one in that line is the doctrine. And that's why we have, over the years, focused a lot on the doctrine. And I would like to see this year that we strengthen our prayer life as a community, as a family. I believe that that will give us a different edge, right, in the spirit, a discernment, a clarity, a strength, and endurance, and remove some of the resistance that sometimes we face and come our way. So prayer is something that we should do daily, not two times a week or once a week or if I pray. And it's the same with fasting. It's a when you fast. So it's not if, it's when. So fasting should be something that is part of our lives. Amen? Is that true? It should be part of our lives, because fasting helps us to get control of the flesh and the appetites of the flesh and the desires of the flesh that sometimes get the better of us. But we last week, we looked at the word that it's a time of favor. It's a time of favor. Tell the person next to you, it's a time of favor. Okay? Drilling it into the person. Ask the person, do you know what time it is? Favor. Favor. Now, I spoke to Tani Mimi, and she said there's quite a number of testimonies there in our house church concerning, you know, favor. And we heard a testimony on, was it Wednesday evening, yeah, of a couple who both got work in the same day. So the Lord is moving and responding. And what I want to do is I want to continue to push back our mind and the way we view ourselves in this time of favor. Amen? I want to push that back, and I do not want us to be, as I use the word, caught in our emotions, caught in our circumstances, and then miss the time of favor, because we are so blinded by what is going on in our lives and the difficulties. Okay, so let's just get Psalm 102 again. Psalm 102 and verses 13. Psalm 102 and verses 13. Okay. So if you read from verses 1 all the way up to verses 12 or verses 11, David starts with saying, Lord, hear my prayer, hear my cry. So in this situation, he's not crying because he longs for God. He's crying because he's in a situation. It's difficult. He describes how difficult it is. He says, one of the things he says, my enemies reproach me all the day, and they that are mad against me are sworn against me. So I've eaten ashes like bread and mingled my drink with weeping. David is in a period, he says he's weeping, he's difficult, he's challenging. It's his cry. It's where he finds himself. But when you spend time with God, when you do what Jesus said, he said words like this: blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted, right? And you would think, why would Jesus say it's blessed to mourn, to be weeping and crying and having something like that? Because he says that is when God can comfort you. But the only way that God can comfort you is if you take your mourning to him. And so this is why David says, Lord, hear my cry. Listen to my prayer. And in the prayer, he starts engaging God and explaining his situation, what he's going through and how he feels. It is in that time, as he's engaging God, as he's praying, he then comes to a revelation. He then comes to an understanding. And so when you are facing a difficult time and you engage God and you take your pain, your struggle, your challenge, your difficulties, and you bring it to God in prayer, then what happens is that God begins to speak to you. And when he begins to speak to you, comfort comes. Right? Now, the Bible says that when you mourn as the world do, it leads to depression. But when you mourn in Christ, you can be comforted. Right? And so many times, the way that we mourn is we just complain, and we mourn like the world, as if we don't have a Savior. We mourn like the world, we cry like the world, we complain like the world, as if we have no one that is there to help us. And so all we do is we complain, we do this, and we say it's tough, and we say this is wrong, and you weep and you cry and say, oh, why did this happen to me? And, you know, but you don't talk to the Lord at all. You don't bring it to him. And that's the mistake that you make, right? And that's the mistake that you make when you don't bring the situation to God and you expect him to answer you and to speak to you and to comfort you in your situation. That's why it's blessed to mourn, because you will be comforted. It is a reality. But when you mourn before the Lord, you will be comforted. And this is what David is doing. He is describing to God what he is going through. He's describing to God his challenges that he's facing and what he's experiencing in his body, in his heart, and so on. And he's coming now and he's saying, God, listen to my prayer. And then he gets caught in this revelation, in this vision, in this understanding, and his perspective begins to change, right? And that's what we want. You want your perspective to change while you're going through the things that you are going through. And this is where he comes in verses 13 in Psalm 102 and verse 13. He says, you will arise and have mercy on Zion. You will arise, not maybe, not if I'm doing right. David doesn't talk anything about that he is holy enough for God to move. He says, you will arise and you will have mercy on Zion. This word mercy means, in the Hebrew, it means a deep love that he has for you. It means a tender affection for you. It means compassion. It means that because of his deep love that he has for you, he will arise. And his compassion will cause him to move on your behalf. Right? So this has got nothing to do with how good you are. This has got to do with what's going on in the heart of God. This is what's got what to do. It's got to do with what is in the heart of the Father for you. Mercy, tender love, right? Compassion and affection for you. It is not, so when you're thinking about this word favor, you're thinking, do I deserve it? It's not talking about whether you deserve it. It's talking about what's going on in God's heart, right? What's going on in his heart is that there is a moving and a stirring in his heart for you. And that mercy causes him to arise, to stand up, to move, not to sit still and be without action. It causes him to move on your behalf. The word mercy, you know, we always think of mercy as asking God to forgive, right? If you did something wrong, then you say, Lord, have mercy, right? But you know that blind Bartimaeus asked Jesus to have mercy upon him. And when he asked for mercy, he was not asking Jesus to forgive him for something. He was asking Jesus to move in his life. Mercy is action. And this is when God moves in your life despite what is going on in your life. Doesn't matter what it looks like and what is the state in which you find yourself, whether you feel holy or not holy. He says, I will have mercy, and he acts based upon who he is, not upon your performance. Are you with me? He acts upon his mercy, his goodness, his love, his tender affection for you, right? I think parents will understand this. Parents will understand that sometimes when your children just don't perform, but when they're in their situation, your love for them moves you, right? And even though you are upset with what was done and the situation, your love for them moves you, right? This David comes to this understanding that God will arise and have mercy. Mercy upon Zion, and he will do it because of his love for us, his affection, how he feels about us. And then it says, for the time to favor, yes, the set time to come, right? It is a time. This is describing the time that we are in. It is regardless of where David found himself, there is a time of favor. There is a time of God's heart being turned towards you to move in a way in your life that is undeserved. You don't deserve it, right? You don't cut to the standard, but God moves because he favors you, right? Because his heart is for you, his love is for you. And in this place, this is the place where your perception of how God sees you has to change, right? And you have to build yourself up in your faith so that you understand that this is how God looks at you. This is how God sees you. This is God's attitude towards you. This is God's heart towards you. Because we always get caught in our struggle. Right? We get caught. We are trapped. We are in bondage. We view ourselves. The way we look at ourselves is according to how we perform. Let me put it like that. How we perform. If you're performing well, you feel that God will move. If you're not performing well, you feel that God will not move, right? It's based upon performance. Amen? Based upon performance. But that is not what we have to do here, right? This verse is saying that you have to lift up your eyes. You have to change your perspective. I know that it is not the way that you would like it to have. You You are facing things, you had difficult situations, things have been coming on long now, and things have not changed, right? And that's why I think the testimony that we heard on Wednesday night was very good. It was moving in that word, right? We move in the word. We move not according to what's happening in our lives physically. We move based upon what God is saying to us. That is what we must do. And we have to strengthen. One of the things that the prophecy says, you have to drive this in, into your heart. You have to drive it in like you hammering a nail into a wall. You're hitting it over and over that this is a time of favor, right? You have to control your speech, and when you see the things that you face, you have to speak to it and say, it's a time of favor. It's a time of favor. God will have mercy upon me. When you think about what you did wrong, then you say, He will arise and have mercy upon me. When you think about the failures that you have, then you say, He will arise and have mercy upon me. Right? Because actually, if you take Psalm 102, this psalm, the first psalm from verse 1 to 12 is actually in part describing the suffering of Jesus. And then how that a time will come when the church will, when the birth of the church, it will be the time of favor. Therefore, it implies that someone else has paid the price for favor to come to you. Someone else has done the work that you may experience favor, mercy, and blessing. Are you with me? That's how we are blessed, right? Through Christ Jesus, because He paid the price to bring to me the blessing. That's why the book of Galatians will say, he who hangs on a tree is cursed. And so Jesus was cursed. He took our curse upon Himself that the blessing of Abraham might come upon us. So someone else did the work. And so we need to view ourselves according to the way that God is now speaking towards us. Amen? Tell the person next to you, stop looking at your circumstances. Stop it. Stop it. Let's go to a verse here in Luke chapter, I think it's Luke chapter 18. Verses 9. Do you know what makes prayers many times difficult? Is because you know your own failures. You know what you are struggling with. Amen? Can I get some hands up here? And that is what makes prayer difficult for you. But when you are unaware of your weaknesses and you feel perfect, it's so easy to pray. Right? Amen? But look at this verse. It says, also, He spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. They were those who felt that they met the standard and therefore they looked down upon others. Right? And then it says, two men went up to the temple to do what? To pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Okay, so in the biblical times, they hated tax collectors. Right? Those were the people that they thought God couldn't have mercy upon. Right? It says, One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Read on. And the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I am not like the other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, and even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. So that attitude makes him think that God must hear him. But read verse. So in verse 11, he describes what he's not doing. In verse 12, he describes what he is doing. Right? Okay? And then verses 13. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He feels he doesn't qualify. Right? He doesn't meet the standard. Verses 14. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. The challenge that you have with praying is because you know that you don't cut it. You know your weaknesses. You know your failures. You know your mistakes. You know what you are doing wrong. You know what you do, what other people do not see. Right? You know how you got angry at home and used a few words you weren't supposed to use. Right? You know how at work they just drove you up the wall. Right? And the thoughts that were going through your mind. Right? You know you. But Jesus says, when you come to pray, you must come not in your performance. You must come basically in the, after Christ died for us, you must come in your identity. I am a son. I belong here. Someone paid the price for me to be here. I have the right to pray. Now, God likes that type of prayer because it's not based upon your performance. It's based upon someone who paid the price for you to be there. Right? And that's why your position in Christ is a permanent position. You, when you are raised to sit with Christ in heavenly places, you sit there because of Him. You don't sit there because of performance. Because the Bible says that He forgave us of our sins. The Bible says He washed us. And the Bible says He made us alive. And the Bible says He raised us up and He caused us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Not one time did he say, because you loved well, He took you up. He kept saying He took us up. It kept saying He made us alive. It kept saying that He forgave us. He washed us. And He took us up and made us sit with Him in heavenly places. Therefore, the one that keeps you in that position is Jesus. Now, when you approach Him like that, He likes that. Because the glory goes to Him. Right? And so not in your performance, right? Not in your performance. It is in what Jesus did for you. He made the way for you, right? And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get you to have at least some confidence when you pray. So that when you hear the words that are set time to arise and have mercy and favor upon you, that you will be able to say amen. That you will be able to take your eyes up off upon yourself and say, yes. It's my portion. And you will find that when you believe that, that something changes inside of you. Amen? Right? So it is that. So the humbling of yourself is your stance upon what Jesus did for me. Right? That's why the book of Hebrews says, come boldly before the throne of grace. Why? That you may obtain mercy and have grace to help you in your time of need. But the Bible also says, come boldly by the blood. In other words, what do you use to approach? My performance or the blood? Come boldly because of what the blood did for you. Therefore, I have boldness to approach. I do not come boldly because I am like the tax collector, the Pharisee that says, I'm not like the tax collector. Or because I'm saying, I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't do that which all the other people do. Therefore, I have the boldness to pray a prayer. Now, make no mistake, your failures and your things that you do, they have an effect upon you. It interferes with you. Make no mistake. You make it harder for you to believe that Jesus, what Jesus did for you. But he is able to hear your prayer, right? He hears your prayer not based upon performance, but upon who he is. He will arise and have mercy. Tell someone behind you, he will have mercy to you. Say mercy. Tell them that means he loves you. Right? He loves you. Okay? He loves you. And so when we are praying and when we are engaging God, because I want to help us to believe, to accept a time of favor, right? You may be short, and you are still battling to figure things out. And you're still trying to find out if this favor is for you. Yes, it's for you. You may be with the Lord years. I know what it's like to be lank mediere, and then that mistake that eats you up. And it eats you, and it eats you, and you feel unworthy. But you never made yourself worthy. Jesus did. Jesus made you worthy and caused you to be accepted. He caused you to be accepted in the beloved. Amen? Are you with me? So it is important that we do something. John chapter 4, verses 34. This is the chapter where Jesus was speaking to the woman at the well, and he was busy talking to her, and he sent his disciples to go find food for him. And when they came back, he said he was not hungry, and they asked him, now, listen, did you get food somewhere else? And he said, this is what he answered. He said, Jesus said unto them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Verse 35. Do not say, there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, look, perceive, understand, change your mind. Behold speaks of looking. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes, a focus, lift up your eyes. And look at the fields differently. For they are already white for harvest. So in the beginning of the verse says, 4 months to harvest. That means naturally, when you look at the harvest, you will naturally see that they are not ready. Amen? Now he says, look at the very same thing with different eyes and see that it's white and it's ready to be harvested. Look into your circumstances again and see that favor, it is the time of favor. That's what he's asking. For you to walk in that word, you will have to look and perceive your circumstance differently. And that's why, you know, when I work with people, I like to remind people of what they say to me, the Lord said to them. Okay? So, you know, so it's a good thing, and some people like it, some people don't. Because with decision making, I remind you of what the Lord said to you. And when you find yourself in your darkest time, I like to tell you what God said to you. Because for me, that's the reality. As a heavenly man, as someone that walks by the Spirit, for me, that is the reality. What God said about you. What God said He would do for you. And that is where we must, and that is where we must not allow our circumstances, the stuff that we face, right, to cause us to look at and say, it is then not the time. That's how you miss the time. That's how you miss it. That's how you can miss the time of favor. That's how you can miss the time that God will arise and have mercy upon him, show himself affectionate towards you, and just show his love towards you, because you are caught in what you are going through. Right? But look at it differently. Look at it differently. Look at your bank account differently. I said yesterday to my wife, I have this thing in my heart. You know, now I know when it's when I don't fuss at me. You know, because I've experienced it many times. When something sits in my heart, then it happens. And I said to my wife, this year I want the income to increase between 300,000 and 400,000 in the church's account. I want it's almost got to double and triple. I'm believing for that, because there's things I want to do, right? I'm believing God for that. You know, and you know what that means? That means God has to bless you to do it.
No clap, Yolanda. No clap, Yolanda.
And I'm believing that God can do that. Right? I'm believing He can do that. Favor. And I'm ready to take the steps I need to take to make that happen. Right? Right? You're not going to come here. I'm not going to put pressure upon you to give more so that we can reach that budget. That's not what's going to happen. You know me. I don't put pressure upon you to increase my budget. My conversation is with the Father. My conversation is with Him. So I just broke my first law. It must be in secret. But I did that for a reason. not to manipulate, but to tell you how we must look at things differently. We easily accept as the norm what we are going through. Or your bank account, it's been like that for 2-3 years. Every month is net I 5 days with the cray. Or I 10 days, or how much I get. But you don't look at it differently, saying, God, this thing can change. Right? This is what the scripture is saying. Look at the very same thing differently. Look at it differently. Look at this year differently. Look at your work differently. Look at your bank account differently. Look at your weaknesses differently. And see that it is a time of favor. A time of favor. It is a time of favor. Do you know how you know in the body of Christ what time it is in the spirit and the season that you are in? The simplest way that you know is God uses preachers. That's how he does it. You want to know what's happening, what God is doing? Listen to what the preacher is telling you. Right? Okay. Let me give you an example. Let's go to Romans. So God made it easy for you. All you have to do is Romans chapter 10. Verses 15. All you have to do is by the Spirit hear what the preacher is saying. All you have to do is ask the Holy Spirit, let me hear what you are saying. That's all you have to do. It says, and how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. And this word beautiful, as I've explained to you before, is a word that means belonging to the right hour, time, and season. And then it says their feet, how beautiful are the feet. In other words, they walk in those seasons. They walk in those times. And therefore, their message is good news because it's declaring to you the time and the season and the hour in which you find yourself. Right? So the way you know the season that you are in is by what the preacher is saying. Or more that God uses the prophets. And the prophets are speaking, they're telling us it's a time of favor. It's a time that God will arise and to have mercy upon you. He will have favor upon you, that you should expect uncommon blessings. Right? So the way that you know is simply by listening to the Spirit through the mouth of a preacher. And if you can hear the Holy Spirit when he is speaking, what time it is, then, and you move in that time, you move according to the Spirit, then what happens is things start to move, right? Things start to shift and change. This is,
And the way that we walk in the Spirit is we walk according to that word that was spoken. That word that was spoken. That word that was spoken over us. That word is, that's the time. It's a time of favor. It's a time of favor. And what the enemy will do is, he will produce resistance. So that when you look at your physical circumstances and situations, it looks to you that it will not change. And it puts pressure on it so that you will believe rather what you see with the natural eye instead of believing what God said to you. And God wants us to look differently. Drive in the concept, the idea, the truth that it is a time of favor. Time of favor for us. Right? Let's go to Numbers 13 verse 31. Now this is the chapter where Moses sent out the spies to spy out the land of promise, the land of Canaan. And he sent out the spies and he said, go spy the land, see how good the land is, right? See whether they're living in tents, they're living in houses, are they weak, are they strong, are they many, is it cities, what is it? Spy the land, right? Do you know how you spy your land? You allow God to cause you to see what the future looks like. That is spying out your land. Right? Spying out your land is when you engage God in prayer and He begins to show you your future. Spying out your land is when a prophet comes to you and declares things over your life and shows you what you will be doing. That is spying out your land, right? But as they go into the land and they came back, verse 31, it says here, Let's read verses 27 first. Then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey. And this is its fruit. And what did they bring? They brought, what's the next one? They brought this first fruit. It was so big that they had to carry it on their shoulders. Right? And so they can acknowledge that the land is good. We can acknowledge that what God wants to do in our lives is good. Amen? Well, the Bible says, I know the plans I have towards you, plans not to harm you, but to give you a hope and a bright future. How many times have you heard that God wants to bless you? How many times have you heard that God has good things in store for you? How many times have you heard that God has great plans with your life? How many times have you heard that God's mind towards you is good and favorable, right? Has that happened to you? We can hear those things so many times. But verses 31, but the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we, right? Next verse, verse 32. And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature. Verses 33. And there we saw the giants, the descendants of Anak, came from the giants, and we were like grasshoppers in whose sight? We were like grasshoppers in whose sight? And so we were in their sight. You know what? You know what the problem is? The problem is how you see yourself. That's why you struggle to take that word, time of favor, time of mercy. Because the way you view yourself is you view yourself as not worthy. You view yourself as not someone who is able, or I am not perfect enough for that word to happen to me. The way you view yourself is the way you cancel what God wants to do. You are canceling the favor that He wants to bring to you, the mercy that He wants to show to you, because of the way you view yourself. And it's not about how you see yourself, it's about what He is saying to you. When Moses gave God all the reasons why God shouldn't use him, God kept giving him the reasons why. When Gideon gave God, or the angel, all the reasons why, how can you say it's me that you are going to use? The angel kept saying, it's you. The more the angel said, God is with you, the more he said, how can you be with me? The more the angel said, he is with you. And guess what? When he gave him all the reasons why not, he didn't even change those things. He just eventually started to believe what the angel said, and he started to walk in it. And as he walked in it, the change came with it. Don't let your, where you find yourself, disqualify yourself or what you feel and experience, and use that as a means to disqualify yourself for God to have favor upon you. The time of favor is here. Right? The time to have mercy is here. But that's why this coming week we wanna share some testimonies, because I think when we don't share our testimonies of what God is doing, we get caught. Ons is almal stil. Die Here doen die ding hier met my, and then you just like, die Here doen daar niks. But the Lord is moving. He is moving. Don't disqualify yourself. Don't, the way you look at yourself is the way, is what you use to disqualify yourself. But it is not what God is using to disqualify. Even though they saw themselves as grasshoppers, God said, go possess the land. Right? I'm not perfect. I'm not good enough. God, how can you say this about me? All those type of things. No, it is what He is saying. Right? And He's saying, so we were in their sight. They believed lies. Because they said that our enemies, or the land that we must possess, they view us as grasshoppers. Hulle vat ons hier ernstig op hier. They view us as grasshoppers. But when in actual fact, that was not the truth. That was not how they viewed the people of Israel. Are you with me? Okay? Let me show you that. Joshua chapter 2. Okay? Joshua, that's not you at the back, name. Joshua chapter 2 and verses 9 to 11. Now this is where they crossed over the River Jordan, and then Joshua, who took over now from Moses, sent spies into the land also, into Jericho. And they got the harlot there who helped them, and she said, and she said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the people here of this land are faint-hearted because of you. In other words, before they even got to the land, everybody in that land was fearing them. But they were saying, we are grasshoppers in our own sight, and they see us as grasshoppers. But here, Rahab gives them insight to how the people of that land, that they were describing, those men of great stature, how they were viewing them. They were afraid of the people of Israel because they had heard the things that God had done with them. God has already prepared the places that you must go to. God has already prepared the hearts that you must speak to. Already the places where you must go. Right? The things that you must do. God has already prepared it. It is not the way you see it. As long as you keep looking at yourself, you're going to say it's not right. The time is not right. It is not. Nobody, they. You know, I like Dr. Segi's, one of his testimonies. Dr. Segi is one of, is an international preacher in the, and those of you who know him, he's a mighty man of God when he preaches and so on, and he's done many things. And when you listen to him today, Diamond skrik for niks. Diamond say what he will say, he'll offend you, and it's my class. That's what it is, that's what he here say. That's what the Lord is saying. I'm not interested in what you believe, is what the Lord is saying. And he's sometimes highly offensive, just speaking the truth. But he tells a story. Back in the day, he was never like that. He said he was such a man, a timid man, a fear, a man who was afraid of other people. He said the one time he was standing, I think it was it McDonald's or something like that? One of those takeaways. He was standing there. And while he was standing there, he was next in line. And because he had such a, how would you say, a timid look upon him, so a bangarach, can't talk type of thing, and, you know, it's like, who's going to answer me now? Type of, that look. He's next in line. And the lady on the counter looks past him to the people behind him and says, next. Because the way he viewed himself at that moment, it just nullifies it. If God says to you, you're a mighty man, and you feel not mighty, you believe that you are mighty. If God says to you, favor, you don't look upon yourself as someone who cannot be favored. God says, I will have mercy upon you. You don't look upon yourself differently as what God says. Because when you believe, faith works, grace works by faith. Right? They were afraid. You don't know how many people look at you the way you don't look at yourself. You thinking you're not special, and other people look at you, you're so special. You look at yourself and say, I don't have skills. And other people look at you and say, really? We think you're so highly skilled. You look at yourself and say, what can come out of me? And other people will see, yo, but there's so much potential in you. Don't cancel what God wants to do in your life because of the way you look at yourself. When you think about it and you start saying to yourself, but I don't think I'm qualified. I don't think I'm able to do it. I don't think, you know, all those type of things. That is not how you must view yourself. That is the time when you say to yourself, but that's not true.
That's not who I am, because I am favored. I am, God has prepared the way for me. God has made it open. All those type of things. You declare what the word of God has spoken over your life. A time of favor. Right? Five people, tell them a time of favor. Turn to the person next to you, look at them in the eyes and say, stop it. Stop looking at yourself like that. Tell them, you know what I'm talking about. Hou net op asseblief. Add some etc. Hou net op. Really? That's not who you are. That's not who you are. One of the things my spiritual father, Tamu Naidu, said, that the Lord says is the time of victory and breakthroughs and so on. And he says, even breaking free from low self-esteem. That way you view yourself. That way you see yourself. Not special, not qualified, not good enough, not skilled enough, not clever enough. Too messed up to be used. That's the lie that you are accepting. And that's the lie that you must not accept. Favor. I love you. Mercy. Tender affection. You feel, because of all your mistakes, you don't feel that God loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Favor. Favor. It's not a time to see yourself differently. God has prepared the places that you are going to. God has prepared the hearts that you must talk to. That's what Karu shared with us. He went. God goes before. God said to Moses, I want you to strike the rock. And you know what God did? He went and stood by the rock waiting for Moses to come. He's already there where Moses must be. Amen. God's already there where he will lead you. God's already talking to the people that must move on your behalf. He's already turning hearts. And you're still struggling with yourself. Seeing yourself as a grasshopper. Right? God's already moving where you are not seeing. He's already there where you need to be. Right? He's already there. Don't give him the reasons why he can't. The man at the pool of Bethesda, lying 38 years there, Jesus comes and says, do you want to walk? He should have just said yes. He said, Lord, there's nobody to throw me in. There's always people who jump in before me, giving us all the reasons why. Just said, oh, up, man, fat your bed and loop. Take your bed and walk. Don't give the reasons why. You are not a grasshopper. You are favored. You're a giant. You're a son of God. Come on. You're seated at the right hand of the Father. You are in Him. Right? He don't view you like that. The way you view yourself.
He is moving to places where you are to be. He is already there. Lord, I pray that eyes will open. I pray that the spirit of revelation will open our eyes, that we may see and perceive ourselves according to the way that you view us, Lord, and that which you say to us, Lord, that it will become a reality. I pray that the blindness will be removed in the name of Jesus, Father. No veil shall hinder us from seeing who we are in the Spirit. I pray, Father, that your Spirit will lead us to the places that you have already prepared for us. I pray that the hearts will turn right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, that the doors that must open, that they will open in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. I pray that the contracts that must come, Lord, I pray that the people that you will use to promote us in the name of Jesus, that you will bless them, that they will be able to promote us, Father. Lord, that you will give things that is so uncommon, so unseen in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, open our eyes, stir our spirits, charge us on the inside in the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ. Favor upon you. Favor upon you. I want to push that thing out. Come on. Favor is to you. Favor is to you. I declare that you are forgiven. I declare that you are forgiven. I declare that you are forgiven. Forget it. I declare favor upon you. Highly favored, accepted in the beloved. I declare that over you. Do you know the purpose of prayer? You know what the purpose of prayer is? The purpose of prayer is, okay, let me say one of its purpose, is that God cannot do when you don't pray. That should give you a good enough reason to pray. When you understand prayer correctly, that's if you understand prayer correctly. Because when we have an understanding that God is sovereign, we think that God does everything without us. So al batak ma, hy sal mos net doen wat hy wil. But Jesus said, when you pray, say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. You know what that means? He needs you to pray that his will, that his heart, that which he determines, that which he has decided, that which he has now spoken over you, that his will, it must be done. Where? In the earth. And when we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us and we have the things that we have asked of him. That's what the Bible says. The will of God. That's why it's important to pray. That's why we pray. That's why we pray. Favor. I want to drive this home. Favor. Favor. Come on, let's stand. As you stand, I want you to begin to speak. Speak into the where you should be. Speak, declare. Come in agreement with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Wherever two or three shall agree concerning anything on earth, it shall be done by our Father which is in heaven. We already know the will of the Father. Let us agree on earth. Favor. Declare favor into your life. Declare favor into your year. Declare mercy upon yourself. Declare that hearts are turning. Declare that the place that you are going to, the people's hearts are turning right now in the name of Jesus. Come on, begin to speak.
The Bible says, when you pray, say. You don't pray in your mind. You pray with your mouth. You declare. The Bible says, if you confess with your mouth, you confess with your mouth. Tell over yourself. Speak over yourself. In the name of Jesus, speak. Declare it. Don't cancel yourself. Don't view yourself. Speak over yourself. If you need to say, I am forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I declare favor where I'm going, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that the hearts are prepared, Father, for me. I thank you, Lord, that you are already there where the door must open, Father. I thank you there. You are there in the rock in the hard place, Lord. You will make that rock open and split up, Father, and you will open it in the name of Jesus. You are he who has the keys of death. Lord, you are he who holds the keys in your hand, and you will open the door, and no one will shut it, and you are he who shuts and no one will open. We declare, Lord, that the doors that you have determined for us to walk through, that those doors shall open in the name of Jesus Christ, Father. We declare, Father, your word says, Lord, that you will break asunder the bars of iron. You will open, Lord, the gates of brass, Lord. The bars of iron will not keep us out. The gates of brass will not judge us, Lord. Those doors will open, Lord. Those places shall not stand in our way, Father, because we thank you for the kingly anointing. Father, we declare, Father, that it will happen, Lord. We declare, Lord, that new things will happen in our lives, Father. We declare, Father, that it will change. We declare that it will not stay the same in the name of Jesus Christ. Kendarabo Shatta. Come on, speak, speak, speak. Don't, this is not a time to ask. This is not a time to ask. This is a time to declare, 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 proclaim, decree a thing. Kentarabo shata rabashata. Kendarabo sha. Mokorobo shandaraba shataraba city. Lord, you will open the eyes of people. Lord, you will make them see. When we come to places, they will see us differently, Lord, because of your favor upon us, Lord, because of your glory upon us, Father, in the name of Jesus. Where we go, Lord, the people shall fear us, Lord. The people shall be afraid of us, Lord. There we shall find such uncommon favor wherever we go, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. We declare. Declare that in Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus Christ. Kedorobo shataraba shataraba babande. Come on, yes, speak it, speak it. Speak in agreement with the Father. Speak in agreement with the Father. Lord, we thank you. We declare that this is a time of favor. We declare that this is the time that you will arise and have mercy upon Zion, Lord. This is the time that you will do uncommon things, Father. This is the time, Lord, where you will give us divine connections, Father. This is the time that hearts will change towards us, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. Lord, we declare that, Lord. We come against resistance. We break resistance against us in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. We declare that you open the Red Sea. You split it, Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ. Ketoraba shandaraba shiti. Mekandarabo kosete. Speak it. Speak it. Declare it. Declare it in the name of Jesus. Declare that his will be done. Kondarabo shete raboko sata rebembo shanta raboko sata rababa shata mekandara momo shata rabo shete kitere bebe shete rebe bebe shete enterabo bobo shata rababa shata. No longer shall hearts be against us, Father. No longer shall things be against us, Lord, because we go in the Spirit, Lord, and we command favor, Lord, there where we go, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Kendorobo shekandarababa shata metanamamo shendaraba city. Lord, we know what it is, but we lift up our eyes this morning. We lift up our eyes. We look at it differently. We see it differently. This is a different year, Father, in the name of Jesus. Mekendaraba shata. Korobo sheterebe sheta. Korobo shete. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for your tender love towards us, your affection, your mercy, your kindness towards us. We thank you that what is in your heart is love towards us. Oh, Father, you are our Father. We bless you. We give you thanks. We give you thanks, Father.
Go in after the presence of God and try to.
We thank you for a different year.
Melody, and after a couple
we
of
thank
hours,
you for
it just felt like the presence
change,
of God just
Father. Peace, shalom. Rest from our enemies. Freedom from our enemies.
And this is a blessing over you and your family and your children. So just receive this morning. Just put your hands out in front of you. Turn your heart to a place of just receiving your blessing.
Father, there where people have not gotten work, we declare, Lord, that they shall get work in the name of Jesus Christ. We declare promotions, Father. In the name of Jesus. Divine connections. Divine ideas, Father. Ideas that will advance us in the name of Jesus Christ. Opportunities that will come knocking at our doors. I pray that they will find us, Father. That they will come looking for us, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Wherever we are, Father, may they look for us. Lord, like at the birth of Jesus Christ. When the wise men, the shepherds, they searched for him. To come and find him, Father. To open their treasures to us. Let them find us, Father. Let us be at the right places at the right time. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. Give us wisdom this year. Because your word says in the path of wisdom, there is peace. I pray for ideas that come from the spirit of wisdom. That will bring peace to us. Shalom. Freedom from our enemies. Because we will set ourselves up in such a way that the enemy will not be able to come close. I pray for relationships, Father, to change for shalom and peace. In relationships, Father. Favor. Father, because you say in Psalm 102, when you say the God will, that you will arise and have mercy upon Zion, yes, the time to favor, the set time of favor has come. And then you go on to say, to loose those prisoners, those who are bound, Father. Favor. Wherever we are, may favor follow us. In the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody say amen and amen. Amen.
thousand generations, and your family and your children.